Board meeting, Bridgeport Conference Room at City Hall. Should be noted, all members are present. Got a big agenda tonight, we're not going to go around the room, but when you do speak or request to speak, please introduce yourselves, so everybody knows who you are, you know most of you, but. And I talked to the committee members, and with their approval, we are going to move items six and seven to the front, because Chief Kirkman has another commitment. So, item six, consider for approval quotes to purchase a four-by-four pickup truck to replace the 2008 Chevy van in the fire department.
Okay, you guys got all the information in your packet? Okay, so we put out the bid process. You can see who we all sent it to, so we sent it to everyone that we could think of in the area, in Wisconsin Rapids, Stevens Point, and some in Marshfield. You can see through the numbers that the cheapest bid was Gafiti, and there's a little bit of a difference between the 5.5 and the 6.5, it's a little bit over $100. We prefer to go with that 6.5 foot bed, that's going to work better for us for that $29,551.50. The item is budgeted in the 2017 budget, our outlay, excuse me, and then also, we're also going to be selling that pickup, and we would be using the monies from, there was $25,000 in that, and then I had Lieutenant Forseer actually do a blue book. We're not sure yet if we're going to trade it in, or if we're going to sell it on the auction site, and there you are. How much was the blue book for that van?
The high runs from 8172, and the low is 7705. And the average trade-in is 5138.
Okay, so we'd be covered there in regards to, and then we have a couple lights and stuff like that we have to purchase for it also, so we should be more than fine within our budget. Any questions at all, or?
I'll make a motion for approval for quotes to purchase a 4x4 pickup truck to replace 2008 Chevy van in the fire department.
Can you just put in the motion that the disposal of the current vehicle, either trade-in or at auction, whatever is most advantageous?
For purchase of 4x4 pickup truck to replace 2000 Chevy van in the fire department from Gafiti, 6.5 foot bed with the selling of the 2008 Chevy van and the pickup truck.
Oh, no, just that van, yeah.
Just the van?
Yep.
Just to clarify, it's the sell or trade-in.
Sell or trade-in.
Whatever we deem best.
Whatever we keep the better on.
Yeah. Whatever the best can do.
And now I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Agenda item seven, consider for approval the purchase of a new 9/11 alerting system for fire stations number one and number two.
A little background, but also I wanted to introduce Brian Brown, IT coordinator, who actually is helping me with this process. We started this probably about 2.5 years ago. We were starting to have some issues at Station 2. Station 1, we haven't had a lot of issues, but Station 2 has gradually gotten worse to the point now where Station 2, a lot of the times, and then Lieutenant Forseer can actually speak on that also. He's usually stationed at that station. It's gotten to the point now where Lieutenant Forseer and the other officers pretty much have to walk around with their portable attached to their hip because the paging system has gotten to that point. We initially were hoping that when we put in the new digital phone system, that Solaris would be able to actually do that also, and I'd worked with Jason DeMarco when he was still here. That apparently didn't work real well because the fact that Solaris was unable to meet our qualifications to meet the NFPA 1221 standard for paging systems. So we started looking around to see who would actually qualify. We found five different companies that actually do provide that service. There was only one that was going to meet the criteria of what we were looking at doing. What we're looking at doing is a is more or less a point-to-point, so more or less it goes from the dispatch center by radio, and then it goes to either Station 1 or Station 2. A lot of them have gotten to the point where they're much more sophisticated, where it actually has to go through the dispatch center and actually has to be communicated out that way, and a lot of them actually use a text-to-voice command where actually it's not even the dispatcher's voice. Unfortunately, we're not quite ready. Dispatch isn't quite ready for that. And this system is something that we found that actually we can add to at a later date if we so choose to, and add that piece later. So the recommendation is actually to purchase the 911 system from US Digital. They will actually provide the equipment. We initially had a quote from them to actually do the equipment and the installation. It was rather expensive, so then we actually went back and got a quote from US Digital just for the equipment, and then AV Aero, which is a company out of Appleton. They were the closest that we found that actually was that actually had the insurance and was accredited to actually put in a system that is NFPA 1221 compliant. That still came back somewhat expensive, so then we brought in Brian and his group, and now they are actually, so our city employees that are within his department are actually going to be doing a lot of the installing of the wire and the speakers, which gave us about a $5,000 decrease in the cost. So the overall cost now is $70,960.54. And you can, we'll bring Tim in on how we're going to pay for it.
That's what we're most interested in. Yeah, I mean, we'll see later in the agenda, there's a resolution in the 2017 budget, but basically this will be funded for it. As you recall, after the 2016 budget was completed, we entered into two municipal EMS service contracts, and so that revenue was not accounted for in the EMS services budget, so basically we'll be taking that revenue and appropriating it over to the outlay item to pay for this expenditure.
Any questions at all, or?
Needs to be done.
Yeah, I was saying I really questioned it, so it has to be done.
Yeah, so. And we've spent a lot of time, we've spent probably an extra, probably 3 to 4 months trying to find the most cheapest way, and I think, I'll let you speak, Brian, what do you think in regards to how we're doing it now?
Yeah, I mean, we took some extra time to have Solaris and come in and see if they could do it, but they couldn't meet the standard. And again, just that dispatch isn't prepared to go with a slightly more modern system. This is the only system that can do it. But again, the advantage is that when dispatch can upgrade, we can easily upgrade this system. And also Marshfield is using a similar system, so that would be a huge advantage as well.
Yeah, dispatch is already using this system, so we're able, they're already compatible with that system. They understand that system, so it's one of the reasons why it really worked out well that way. And when we were doing this as a committee, between Brian and the other Brian from IT and myself, and then Doug Van Burkel, one of my lieutenants, we spent a lot of time thinking, because this is kind of what's happened with this system. I don't think the future was really looked into the future of if it's going to be compatible in 20, 30 years. I believe this will be, so.
Sorry. It's okay, we needed that.
I knew I was somewhere.
We were for a little bit later. No.
Yeah. We'll have to get that taken care of.
At least at 20 or 30 years.
Now, where were we?
Exactly.
Go ahead.
I'd like to make a motion then to approve the purchase of a new 911 alerting system for stations number 1 and 2 for the total amount of $70,906.54.
Second that.
And there is a good possibility there's some wire that's already ran at Station 1, and it all depends on how much IP can do. There might be a real possibility that it might even be less than that. But so.
All right. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Thanks, Chief.
Thank you.
Item 2, consider adoption of a chronic nuisance ordinance. All discussions?
I'd like to. First, I'm Kathy Wertz, I'm a landlord. And as you probably know, most of us are pretty passionate about this nuisance ordinance. So thank you for this opportunity to speak. We as landlords have many concerns about the chronic nuisance ordinance before you because it highlights many of the issues we're dealing with in Wisconsin Rapids. We agree there needs to be a chronic nuisance person ordinance. We need to focus on the problems we face as a community. The problem with the chronic nuisance ordinance as it's written today is it clearly holds someone other than the chronic nuisance person accountable. Landlords understand there's a growing problem in Wisconsin Rapids and we feel the pain along with the rest of the city, but this ordinance seems to be written to hold victims responsible for the crimes committed against them. Yes, the landlords are victims. When someone commits a crime at one of our properties, it hurts our business and it hurts our reputation. Majority of Section 5, subsections A through Y, are for crimes that involve damage of one type or another. When crimes occur at a property, the property and business experiences damage. Recent visits by the police damage reputation of the property. The majority of landlords care deeply about our businesses, property, and our reputation. We are victims of physical damage and damage to our reputation. As landlords, we're required to follow the laws as well. Wisconsin State Statute 704.44 states, residential rental agreements that contain certain provisions is void. A residential rental agreement is void and unenforceable if it does any of the following. Allows a landlord to do any of the following because a tenant has contacted an entity of law enforcement services, health service, or safety services. We can't increase rent, decrease services, bring an action for possession of the premises, refuse to renew a rental agreement, or threaten to take any action. In other words, we can't evict someone for calling the police. The nuisance ordinance is written in a manner that puts landlords in a bad situation. We can't put anything in the lease to protect us or our properties against the chronic nuisance ordinance. We also have to comply with the Fair Housing Act. We need to have specific legal reasons for turning an applicant away. There are limitations to using a person's criminal record for rejection. We can't use pending cases, and the individual must be convicted before we can consider it. The current revision of the chronic nuisance ordinance states any premises which has one enforcement action resulting in the manufacture or delivery of a controlled substance or related offenses is identified as a chronic nuisance premises. Identifying a property as a chronic nuisance premises because the person living at the property commits a crime means you assume the landlord had knowledge of the illegal activity taking place. You understand that when a landlord rents a property, we have limited controls on the activities that take place. We have to give a tenant a minimum of 12 hours notice before we can enter the property. I'd also like to provide you some insight as to the impact of a property owner when a drug lab is discovered. Because in 2011, I experienced that. I had no idea the tenants were cooking meth. I'd been inside several times in the months prior to it. Never saw anything suspicious. I talked to tenants regularly. There were no indications of anything like this could be happening. The tenants had a clean police record since 1988. I had no reason to suspect anything. After the police were finished, the tenants were arrested, and I'm faced with a property, a business that's no longer inhabitable. I received the 5-day eviction notice from the police officer, and he said if I didn't serve them eviction immediately, I would be charged as an accomplice. All I can tell you is I didn't want them in there either. But as the victim in this situation, being threatened as being charged as an accomplice, that's not fair to me. And now the chronic nuisance ordinance is going to make me pay the city in addition to all the other costs I had to incur. It took a year to clean that property. It cost $65,000 to clean that property. and it was hard to rent for a long time afterwards because it had a reputation. Now the city wants to hold me accountable for the bad behaviors of the tenants that destroyed that property. You want to make me the victim, responsible for the bad behavior? Where's my trial? Why am I guilty until I prove myself innocent? We understand the city has created this ordinance to recover the costs associated with repeat problems. As business owners, we clearly understand the need to have a cost-effective operation. It's just the city has chosen a method for handling the problem is forcing the victim to pay for something we didn't do. That's extortion. That's what cartels do. This ordinance states that a property is deemed a nuisance after the police are called the third time to make an arrest, issue a citation, or issue a summons and complaint. When looking at a potential tenant, we do look at Wisconsin Circuit Court access. But how do we find out about warnings? How do we find out if the applicant is a high risk? When I evict someone, I'm facing a potential fee, I'm just sending that person down the road to the next landlord. We aren't fixing the problem. We're just moving the problem. How can we protect our businesses if we can't get access to a complete picture of a potential tenant? This ordinance will fill the court dockets with evictions and cost landlords more and anger the courts further. These costs to the city are real. The burden for these costs needs to be applied to the people that are breaking the law, not the victim. This needs to be a chronic nuisance person ordinance. When you hold people accountable for their actions, they become better citizens. Only then the community wins. Bottom line is if you make the business owners, the victims, responsible, who's going to want to be a landlord in this town? Continued victimization of business owners diminishes the overall view of our community. And in summary, we propose you make this chronic nuisance person ordinance. Let's hold people accountable. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was very good. She said everything I wanted to, but mine's a little bit more informal. I'm Bob Woodrock. I'm with the Landlord Association. I just wrote down some basic things I just wanted to point out to you folks, and I appreciate the time to be able to talk to you. But the first thing that we talk about in the meetings is common sense. My world works on common sense, and in this, I see none of it. You talk about you have problems at 10 properties, and the solution is let's fix those problems in those 10 properties. Get a hold of that landlord, do whatever you have to do to get them out. But I don't see why everybody has to get involved. They do need to fix the problem and not move them over to someone else. My second one is a good neighbor. We have to be good neighbors. I buy my properties, I fix them up, I put my people in there, I try to take care of everything. I know that I take and have a responsibility to keep these properties up and that they can keep them safe, of which I do. Where I have the responsibility for the person living in there is beyond me. The responsibility, and that's where it comes back, the responsibility, I have adult children. I'm not responsible for their actions once they leave my home and they're an adult. So why can a bill be made that I'm accountable for someone living in my house that I've only met for 2 hours and ran numbers on them and talked to them? I don't know where that's going. You talk about investments in the city of Wisconsin Rapids. Well, I can tell you the ordinance I got for material adverse fact with real estate agents. My wife is a real estate agent. Any person that comes into this town, if this goes through, she will have to tell them that you're responsible for your landlord. And that'll create people wanting to run here to do that. Taxes on the property taxes, we feel we're already getting charged once for police protection or do what they have to do with it. I don't know why we get doubled in. On a personal opinion, on my personal situation, I own 20 houses. In this town, I fixed them all up. I got them in great condition. I wanted to build this up that they could pass it on to my kids. But after this came up and what we deal with water and light, I sold 3 last year, I'll sell 5 this year, I'll sell 5 next year, and I'm out. And Wisconsin Rapids no longer holds an investment opportunity for me. And that's kind of where we are. One of my last questions when I was leaving the house, I just wrote this down. I don't know what I would do when a person comes to me and wants to rent my property and I check it out, but I got a bad feeling that he may be bad. And so I'll have to tell him I can't take and rent to you because there's a nuisance law. I got a feeling you may be bad. Where is that book? But those are just a couple of the points that we hit, that we have talked about, and appreciate your time. I'll hang with this. Thank you very much.
I'm Randy Jones, interim chief of police right now. I think there's a lot of misconceptions out there right now with this ordinance, and I'd like to address that, and I think some of your concerns also I'm going to hit on here, and hopefully we can answer any of the questions. Chronic nuisance ordinance. This is generally or basically the same ordinance that was proposed this spring, I believe it was April or May, came up. We did meet with a group of landlords at that time, and we made some changes to it, and I'd just like to go through it. The reason for the chronic nuisance ordinance, obviously, we're having numerous calls to some properties around town. Now, this could be a business property, this could be a rental, this could be an owner-occupied premises, too. It's not strictly for rental properties. And the big underlying theme to this is, what about the neighbors? You talk about being a good neighbor. What about those neighbors that have to live next to these properties? Right. They're paying taxes too, or paying rent on that property. They're trying to do things right. So it's trying to give them conditions that they would expect, and we would all expect from our neighbors. And again, it's to address the excessive time and dollars that are spent on dealing with these same properties over and over and over. Couple properties that we're dealing with right now. One of these is owner-occupied. One of these is a rental. First example, we've had 22 calls there since January 1. It's primarily us, law enforcement. Ray's not here, and we didn't discuss the addresses, but I don't know if ordinance is dealing with these properties too, but just from our perspective. And one is a rental property. So, but as you can see, and for those that can't see, 22 calls at one property, 19 calls at another, and this is since January 1st, so 2.5 months. I don't know how many of you have your packets with the ordinance, but this is generally what it states as we go through the different paragraphs. No property owner may maintain a chronic nuisance premises. And the chronic nuisance premises is 3 violations within a 120-day period. I'll go over some of the violations here shortly. And then just one violation for manufacture or delivery of controlled substances. Well, obviously we have one example here who did have a drug situation at a residence where a search warrant was served. So that would be so these are some of the violations which would count harassment, disorderly conduct, violent crimes, talking assault and battery, sexual assaults, thefts, stolen property, drug possessions, weapons, noise complaints. This also includes building and plumbing, electrical codes, fire and safety codes, public nuisance ordinance, that's chapter 25 in the municipal code right now, something that our nuisance or our ordinance officer deals with. And also includes alcohol, including social hosts, which is underage alcohol parties, basically, and also county or state health code violations. Does not include any calls for assistance that is made by the owner or the occupant, relating to domestic abuse, sexual assaults, or stalking. If there's a second violation within 120 days, the owner is contacted by first-class mail. The owner shall, within 10 days after receipt of notice, provide a written course of action to abate the nuisance activity to the chief or chief inspector. Now, this is what we're looking for. We're looking for compliance at this level. We don't want your money. We don't want it to go further. We want to take care of the problem. We want to return the property, the neighborhood, back to normalcy. That's what we're looking for, ultimately. And hopefully, you know, this is all the further it needs to go. We don't have to look at charging the extra fees for our time, but we're just looking for compliance. The plan that is submitted may be accepted or rejected, or work with the owner to modify, and then a written notice given whether the plan is rejected or accepted. And then if additional violations occur, that's when the special charge would come into effect. Again, we don't want it to get to that level. We want to be able to correct the problem. And the cost, well, the special charge includes cost of police or other staff that respond to the property, and also any administrative fees. And again, this ordinance, what we're trying to do is just promote compliance to get the corrections made on these properties so other neighbors are not being bothered. And I'm sure some of you have yourself, some of these properties where you've had problems with your renters, you get in there after they leave, there's a lot of damage there, so it may be saving you a lot of time and money too in the long run. But the bottom line for all this is, it involves the property owner. Yes, we understand these are supposed to be adults, but when we go there, we arrest, we issue citations, that only has so much effect, and we can only do so much at that level, and we're looking for another step, somebody else that can help us, and whether it's evict these people, somehow get it corrected. On the other hand, you're the property owner too, so ultimately it's your property, you are responsible for it, but we're trying to get the property or the problem corrected. There's potential financial penalty if no compliance, and promote compliance by creating a plan like I talked about. And what we're trying to do is maintain a healthy and safe city, maintain property values for all property owners. I'm sure some of our councilmen or council people here tonight have had questions to them about this nuisance property next to them, how it's affecting their property values. And we've had that question, so it's a question that does come up from others. But again, the bottom line is create necessary change for the properties to be compliant and to prevent deteriorating neighborhoods. So like I said, we aren't looking to fine you or a charge that's extra fee. That's not the reason for this. If we don't get compliance and we have to push a little harder, yeah, then we need to do something. But we're just trying to eliminate the problem for everybody concerned. For you, the landlord, for dealing with the headaches, but also for the rest of the neighborhood that has to deal with that firsthand. Yes, sir.
I have a question. You want the people out because they're a nuisance here and it's bothering the neighbors. So we're going to get him out because I don't want him on my property either.
Correct.
Now, where's he going to go? He's going to go over to Kathy's and rent from her, and then she's going to have to get him out in 6 months. And then he's going to go over to Zerfield, and he's going to have to get him out in 6 months. I mean, somewhere it's got to stop. And you're right. You say we got to get in there. We all got to get involved, and we'd like to stop it now. So what do we got to do with this guy? You throw him in jail? Do you fine him heavily? I mean, they're not going to pay yet because they're back doing my rent and with water and light. And you're going to build more jails? I don't think so.
Well,
so how do you stop the problem?
I see a couple options. Like you said, yeah, they can bounce around property to property,
yeah,
which
we know
may be the case. I think it's happening now even. They get evicted from one or leave one and they go to another one. Obviously, there's Leave Town, which would be great. But also, it's their deterrent. They need to grow up. They need to change. If they're going to be able to stay into in a residence to call their own for a while, they need to make some changes. So,
but how am I going to change him? I mean, how am I going to do that? How do I do that?
Well, by not allowing them on your properties.
Okay, so now he's over on Kathy's. How is she going to do it?
But if they're causing problems, you know they have a past history of problems. Why would you want them in your property?
Where am I
going
to find that? They have to go to court. It has to be put on.
Well, I'm saying somebody, say a current renter that you're dealing with.
Right.
You know they're a problem. Why would you want them on your property?
Well, I don't. I want to get rid of them as just as I can.
Okay. Exactly.
But I don't want Kathy's coming over to me because she had a problem with it. Now I got them by mistake. They lie. You wouldn't probably believe that, but they do.
Yeah.
It's hard to check them on everything.
I think what Bob's saying is, like, how are we going to find out about it? Because, like, through the fine system, we find out through the CCAP.
Mm-hmm.
But on the municipal level,
right,
we may not find out about that. So we don't know. And my other question that I have is, now that this is at my property, and that's deemed a chronic nuisance property, now I get rid of them, is the burden lifted on that property? Is it still marked as a chronic nuisance property? Or how is that lifted?
Isn't there a time frame that it's considered?
Right, after, if once you're determined to be a chronic nuisance premises, then you do the abatement plan, and then if you have 180 days without incidents, I mean, then you're starting over.
So if I get that person out, then I have a 6 month that's deemed a chronic nuisance property for 6 months?
Well, no, it's I mean, you're I'm assuming you're saying that you've got the 1, 2,
yep.
3,
got the one,
got the notice,
yep,
did the abatement plan,
yep,
and then if you're clean for 180 days from that point,
mm-hmm.
I mean, then you're not pulled back into violating the nuisance, the chronic nuisance plan, plus then you, there's at least 120 days has passed, so then your last one, I mean, all three have fallen off, so.
That's a 6 month wait kind of to clear out. It's still deemed a chronic nuisance property for 6 months.
Well, it's a rolling, I mean, I would say it's for, yeah, 6 months, I'm sorry,
yeah.
180 days is 6 months, yes.
Yeah.
6 months from the time of the abatement plan.
Which is kind of crazy, just because if we get that bad person out, now that property is still chronic on the chronic list for 6 months, 180 days.
Right, but I think if you're complying with the abatement plan, and then you can say, well, I got a new person in there, and this
mm-hmm.
is like a, I mean, I don't know what your fourth, you know, what your fourth is, but I'm assuming we're going to be happy that you got the person out,
mm-hmm.
and probably not going to be. I'm sure we would say that you're making progress on your plan, and we're happy with that.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly.
I mean,
I think part of the problem is that the municipality does not report the CCAP. So.
Well, those are all right, and those are all ordinance violations. They're not crimes, so it's,
right.
CCAP doesn't. Do
so they bounce or they'll bounce around amongst us, and we won't really know if they got that chronic nuisance. It's kind of like the water light now. We are now calling Water Works Lighting and saying, hey, do they owe a bill? You know, because they'll stick that name in kids' names and everybody else's names.
Well, you'll be notified after 2 and after 3.
No, but let's say somebody's at Helen's and they come to me. Is there a way that I can call the city and find out, are they a chronic nuisance person? You know?
Well,
they're not,
they
not
have chronic nuisance people. This is fee-for-service ordinance. It has nothing to do with people doing wrong or prosecuting people, or it's a fee for, it's extended, expansive services, or just like if you're not mowing your lawn, you're not shoveling your snow.
Mm-hmm.
After a certain number of time, then you get, you know, in trouble.
But the person that's the chronic nuisance person moves out, and I'm left, like what Kathy's working the victim, because now my property is deemed a chronic nuisance property. And the reason is because we can't catch it fast enough. Like that's, you had 22 calls since January 1.
Yeah.
So, like, how can we catch this fast enough when we're dealing with the courts? Why we go to the eviction process, get on the court calendar, they still can be getting.
This has nothing to do with the eviction process, and I hope that you're not using this ordinance in the eviction process. This doesn't change.
We can't. It's not possible.
So I don't.
Right. Yeah.
So.
But so, how are we going to get them out?
You're a landlord. I don't know. What do you mean? Get them out?
What
this has nothing to do with making it easier or harder to get them out. I think you're misunderstanding what the ordinance is about.
I'm very concerned.
You still have a very hard job as a landlord. I admit that.
Yeah.
This has nothing to do.
That's why we feel it's an unfair ordinance.
I'd like to speak from another angle. I am a landlord, but I'm also a homeowner. And I was in an abusive relationship. And my ex was harassing me. He was coming to the home, peeking in the windows. He was giving me numerous phone calls day after day after day. And there was no restraining order yet. When I called the police, some of the officers that responded didn't give a damn. I had to call the supervisor. My neighbors would be texting me, asking me if I'm okay in the house. Because they knew I was okay, they didn't call the police. But if all week long he's repeatedly coming to my home, I could have had 3 calls in 1 week. I could have been deemed a chronic nuisance.
Who made the call?
I'm giving a hypothetical.
And it's a, well, I'm just saying, there are exceptions.
My neighbor could have made the call.
There are exceptions for those instances.
Right. That's correct.
Or it just says harassment on
it. It says harassment. I had no restraining order yet. I didn't make the call. The neighbor made the call.
But you're the victim of the harassment.
Exactly.
And
I'm also
owner.
The victim.
So it's exempt for the property owners for calls regarding.
I didn't make the call. The neighbors did. In there it's worded that the homeowner makes the call.
Well.
Now, also, I did
some
research. But in that
case, they're calling on your behalf, though. Obviously,
that's not what the ordinance
the
says.
But are they're calling because something's happening at your premises at that time?
Correct.
What is happening at the premises?
I was being harassed. He was peeking
through
the windows.
He was coming to the house.
Yes.
Right.
And there was no restraining order in place. Now, if that was a tenant of mine, I'm responsible for somebody else harassing my tenant, and my tenant is also the victim. I've done research, and you can type it into the computer, and who's harmed by nuisance ordinances? It's all tenants who need emergency and police aid, particularly those who are crime victims or have disabilities, landlords who may face liability under the ordinance and under federal and state laws if they evict, law enforcement agencies which receive fewer reports of crime undermining community safety. Women are not going to... They're not going to call.
And you're calling for especially a reason of your safety, that's not going to be a strike against that property. Or,
if a woman calls to report a crime, it's going to become a nuisance. According to your ordinance, it will be a nuisance. So then the landlord gets the notice that there's a nuisance there. Not only is the landlord the victim, the woman is the victim.
I don't see it that way.
Study after study after study. That's what happens. Women refuse to report the crime. They beg the neighbors not to report
the
crime.
What is the study that you're referring to?
Right here. I've got them all. And like I said, just type it in, and it's there. It's there. The women are the ones who are a huge victim in this because they're not going to report the crime because they are mentally abused that they don't want to report the crime. They know they're going to be evicted. They have nowhere to go. The ordinance needs more study.
Activity does not include domestic abuse.
It does include harassment. Scroll above.
Talking of sexual assault, harassment, yes. But if they're a victim, if they are in danger of being harmed, it's not going to be a strike against them if they call.
According to this, that
and
becomes
we
a chronic
would be
nuisance.
We're reviewing these, though, individually, too. We aren't just going to say, oh, this one's got two, send a notice. That's not the case.
That's not
we'll
how
be
it reads, though.
Reviewing what the violations are.
It is not how it reads. And, you know, you say you want to correct the problem, then you go after the nuisance person.
A call does not count as a nuisance activity.
I am not
okay,
a police
so
officer.
I just want to be clear. Calls do not count. There's a call that doesn't. There has to be an enforcement action that follows it. Written violation, a citation, written remedial letter. So I just want to be clear on that.
Could we get back to what you actually presented to us on the 22 calls to one rental? This, as a taxpayer, a landlord, and really someone that would like to have some kind of equity and fairness in the system, why isn't there something on our books right now that about the fifth call something was done so you don't have 17 more calls? There's nothing in our ordinances that can help you out yet? This is craziness. Nothing has been written on 22 visits?
What do you mean?
He showed us, sir.
Some of our properties we're dealing with right now.
You have a business of 25 and a landlord of 22, and there's nothing been done, and this was in January?
Right, there is no ordinance to notify landlords.
There's nothing on our books
right
that Ray Stark can't take, or you as an officer can't take?
To do what?
To
notify?
To not be on 22 visits.
Well, right. That's right.
This is unbelievable to me.
Because these violations aren't, they're about... when you write a citation, it's for a person, it's not for a property. That's why this brings the property in. And that's why I called the 22, otherwise there might be 20 different people that did those 22 things.
You know the owner of this property, you know the owner of the business.
Right?
I mean, they're paying taxes, waterworks and lighting and everything else. So do something about it.
So.
Like what we've got on the books right now.
Okay.
Property owner are not the problem, it's the person in the building. Cite them, give them a citation, kick them out or throw them in jail. We don't want them either. And we don't have the authority to do that.
If they're on your lease, we can't kick them out. They have legal right to be there. We do, we issue citations, we make arrests.
So why isn't our problem then?
And they go back.
They have more rights than we do.
They have, yeah, they do. They have more rights than we do. Why isn't our problem? Their behavior, why is it our fault?
Well, you're the property owner though.
We're the owner, we're renting to them, it's our business.
We can't do that.
It is your.
Somebody can come to your home if you, say you have an alley in your backyard. There's a nice little dark corner there. And somebody wants to piss you off. They're gonna come there and they're gonna do a drug deal on your property. Boy, a neighbor calls the cops, you're at fault.
Well, that's. Yeah, that's much different. If they're living at your property.
One time, no abatement.
Unless they're, no.
Calls do not count. It's a call, it's not calls, it's enforcement actions.
Okay, so if there's a drug bust in, say, like the parking lot at Burger King.
Mm-hmm, right, exactly.
Burger King is liable.
If they get four, if they get three.
A drug bust is fine.
And then what's wrong with them?
One time.
One time per drug bust.
No abatement.
One time for a drug bust.
Yeah, then we might call them in and just say there's this activity going on at your restaurant. That's quite possible. Manufacturer or deliver, not just simple possession. What?
Even if it's after hours. Somebody has a business that closes at 5 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the morning.
I made one comment. I think what's being lost here is you're not automatically getting fined and paying for that cost of service once you meet that, whether it's three calls or one call, you're not automatically being charged. What is happening at that point is we're asking that we meet with you, that you provide a plan for abatement. If you're working with the city and doing that abatement plan, we are not charging you for those additional services at that point. We're working with you as a partner to try and remedy the situation. If Burger King situation happens, we meet with Burger King. Let's say it's a dark alley portion of the lot. Maybe the abatement plan is that they put additional lighting to try and discourage that. They complied with that. It's part of their plan. They're not getting charged for service if another drug deal happens. It's trying to work towards a solution to avoid these situations. That's the purpose of this ordinance. It is not to just automatically start charging people. And I just want to clarify that really the actionable item here is that plan. It is not the charge for service.
I believe we've asked about charges before and yet no figure can be given. And then it also says for future enforcement, what are the charges if it goes to court? Are we charged for the officer's time to go to court? Are we charged for the person to do the data entry?
If what goes to court?
If say there's a drug bust and the person's fighting.
The drug bust has nothing to do with, right. I mean, that's
but according to this, we're charged for future enforcement.
If there's no plan, if there's no abatement plan made, if the property owner is not taking the proper steps, then there's the possibility of a fee being charged. It's not going to be a, you got one strike, you got a renter who is producing meth. You're going to get charged from that from step one. Well, this case, I guess, was special because of cleanup costs and stuff. But you aren't going to be getting an additional city charge on top of that. If we do a search warrant for crack, it's at that time you will be notified. This is what you got going on in your premises. We want you to come up with some plan to correct that so it doesn't happen again. If you're doing that, that's it.
And
there will be no fees charged.
How is making an abatement plan going to stop somebody from doing the activity if it's going back to an abuse situation again? Landlord? They try and make an abatement plan. The guy keeps coming.
I don't see how the abuse situation gets to the abatement plan.
And
just so I can.
Harassment.
I mean, the way I read this, the enforcement action would have to be taken against someone who's legally occupying the property. So if someone's at your house doing that,
okay.
I don't think that applies
so
to this ordinance at all.
Explain to me theft then. So
that's,
you're going to call and report yourself for stealing something from yourself?
No.
I mean, if someone comes to your house and steals something, you're the victim. You're not the offender.
Okay, say somebody leaves a bike behind your garage and stolen.
Again, that person's not legally occupying your property. So if someone just walked in behind my garage and sold someone a bag of dope or something, I'm not maintaining the chronic nuisance property the way I understand that. That person just randomly, he's trespassing on my property. So I'm off the hook as far as this ordinance goes. Unless I know that my buddy comes over so he can hide from the cops that are watching his house, and then he does it, that'd be a different situation.
I think our biggest problem is the water and light, where we get dinged by these guys. And water and light does not, I got a guy right now who owes me $483 for just sewer and water. But Energy Assistance pays for the electric bill. So electric bill's at zero, but they don't split that money. So now I got $483 in this guy, and they will not shut the water light off. Okay, and I had a couple of them last year that got tagged to my tax bill. So, you know, back in 1800s, that law came on the books that they can legally do that. I think that's what we're worried about. This ordinance gets on the books. And sure, right today, there's no problems, okay? But 20 years from now, 20, you know what I mean? When our, like Bob's saying, the next generation that wants to be landlords, okay, we had an apartment association meeting last night. We had a young guy sitting right here. He wants to buy property. Okay, Bob wants to sell his properties. Who in the world wants to get in this business when we're dealing with these problems? You know, and we're struggling. We don't have the authority that you have as law enforcement or as a city. We can't, there's certain things that we have laws against too. And these ordinances get on the books and it just ties us up. Like, what do we do? How do we deal with these people? We're like beside ourselves, and we're paying taxes, we're paying insurance, we're paying maintenance costs, and these people just stick us. They stick us on the water bill. Now they're just, I'll tell you a good classic example of it. I had a guy, he was a drug dealer. He busted off the inside of the toilet, and it ran. I had $1,154 water and sewer bill. Now, because of experience, water and sewer says, hey, we'll notify you guys when that happens again. But the point is, they can, if I rent to this person, this law's on the books, and they start knowing that, they start talking about that, they just start calling problems to us, because they know at the end of the day, we're going to get nailed.
I can't speak for water and light. And
no, but that's why we're so worried. That's what happens. This stuff gets on the books. And then we're like, wow, how are we going to deal with this? You know,
that started out on water and light. We're just here to help you. And the minute they got that thing passed through, boom, taxes lift right up because we're not going to get it from this guy. Just put it on my tax, I'll pay the $11. Like, I can't take it off. And that's where the concern is. They said we're just going to help you on the next thing we know we're stuck.
I mean, can we come together? I mean, we are landlords. We wouldn't be here if we weren't concerned
doing that.
You know what I mean? We're citizens, we're landlords. Can't we come together? And
I know my perspective's different, but I see this as a coming together. We're working with you. We're letting you know what's going on your properties. And we're hoping you work with us to get
that
property.
We're going to.
Then why is it the person that's causing the nuisance the one that's responsible?
Exactly. Well, they're still being arrested and being charged or whatever the process is. They're still going through that. But
these fees,
we need help to be.
So how do you think a citizen, we don't have a police science degree. We didn't go to school for that. We don't carry a gun. We don't carry a badge. How do you think, as a landlord, we're going to stop the behavior? You can't stop the behavior.
Because you can get them off your property.
We can evict them for certain things. There are laws we have to follow.
Okay, if you're working within the law, and we're working together, you won't have to worry about any fees or any penalties assessed to you. We got a question. He's been waiting a long time over here.
I'm just wondering what your property is. Label a nuisance property, are we required to notify the next tenant that this is a nuisance property? And if so, how are we going to rent it? They're not going to rent the property.
Well, it hasn't, no, because it has nothing to do with the renter. This is a property owner ordinance and a fees for service to. Do you have a question about that? It's a fees for
it
service.
Stays at the end.
It's fees for service to. It's just like, you know, you're not shoveling your driveway. You're not doing your. It's a. It, we send resources to your properties, and we send them once we've decided once they're sent a certain number of times within a certain number of days, which has been greatly reduced. I mean, with that change, we took out the chronic nuisance landlord designation. I mean, basically, we met a couple times, and we kept changing things, and now every time we come here, it's something else. But it has nothing to do with the people in your property.
Sure, they should be the nuisance tenant, not the owner.
They're the ones causing the problem. You're talking in circles.
But if these people are doing things wrong, then they're getting ticketed, and
we're getting mail too. Mm-hmm. And the fines that we should be acquiring should be going to the tenants. They should be paying those fees, not us.
We have a concern about a notification process.
We'll be notified is what we've
in a timely manner that's accurate, that I can take in front of Judge Wolf or Judge the other three judges and just say, this is not even the current address for the person. And I've had that happen. And he said, bring me back a corrective piece of paper.
Okay.
Because the police went to the property and they took the wrong information off an ID that wasn't even current. So we need current, factual, actual.
It's
going to
be
reporting.
It's going to be for enforcement activity at the properties that you own.
You know, some of the problems that we've seen, police talking here now, are people that aren't even on the leases.
Squatters.
And how do you get them out?
Because the friend is there, the girlfriend is there, the boyfriend is there, whatever, and whoever they're allowing on to stay there is the problem. Well, but that's when you can come down on your tenant and say, this person is not belong here. You're the only one on the lease, whatever. Just the warning of being evicted, but that's where you've got powers that we don't get things corrected, and we're looking for your help on this. We need more help to get some of these problems taken care of. And so we're looking to you.
As a landlord, I'm the first guy to step up, and I'll help you on anything you need on any property I get. And I think any of these landlords here will do the same thing. We don't need another law in the books that's going to take and bind us. You just tell us what you need as a landlord, and we'll get it done.
But exactly, there's nothing binding then. So, I know most of you are good people, and if we came to you and said, this is going on, we got to get corrected, most of you would. But there would be some that. Yeah, so what? My rent's coming in. I don't care. So that's where this, I guess, gives us a little teeth to make sure we're getting some help. Right. Yes, sir. You've been waiting a while.
John Smith comes by, fills out an application, and he's the guy that had the 22 citation or calls by a call the Rapids Police Department. Are you going to tell me with John Smith that caused the problem?
Well, the 22 calls went to the property, and that's how we're keeping track.
You don't know who the
offenders
were?
Is your question whether or not we can pre-screen to see if they have caused nuisance activity at other properties?
Right.
Is that your question?
Yes.
So we call the city.
Just like Waterworks and Lighting have agreed, then we can call them and we can say, hey, does Mary Jones owe any money? Now, I don't know if that's legal or not for them to tell us, but
they are.
You know what I mean? That's a whole nother. That's a whole nother can of worms.
Yeah, that would be.
I'm not giving legal advice regarding what Water and Light's doing.
No, but can you guys do that? Can you tell us? You know, hey.
If they're not minors.
Well, right. I don't think we're going to be every time anyone in the entire city is a subject of an enforcement action that we're going to be trying to figure out where they live and then telling you you didn't somehow letting the whole world know that.
But you're telling me.
I mean, you can make an open record request.
You
can make an open record request. Yes, and then you're going to get the notice. If you own the house, you're going to get the notice.
You just said you're not going to worry about where this person lives.
Well, I'm not going to worry about telling. So if it happened at your house, I'm not going to be telling these landlords about it. So it's your problem.
When he moves them. 22 problems here, goes to Kathy to rent. You're not going to tell her, oh, yeah, he was a.
We're not going to get involved in the landlord-tenant relation, first off, nor are we going to get involved in your lease. We are going to follow the ordinance. And this is an extra thing we can do that then, once you're at three or four, we'll talk to that property owner and say, this is the history we have. This is the instances that we have at your property. Why I don't understand why that's.
You're saying you want to work with us,
right?
But when we ask you if this person is a problem, you won't tell us.
You can't call.
Is it not a public record?
Yeah, you can make an open records request. Exactly.
If there's a charge, it'll be on there.
You can make an open records request.
Well, if it's not a charge, it doesn't count for us.
It's not a nuisance.
Well, it does if it.
A citation needs to be issued, correct? For a charge?
Well, for a violation of a citation.
So this house had 22 calls?
Could be a citation or arrest. Pardon me?
You had a house here with 22 calls? How many of them were issued citations or whatever you want to call it?
I couldn't tell you offhand. I really couldn't.
So it may not be a nuisance residence.
But we can make an open records request.
We've done that that many times.
Well, you're telling me, how many citations.
Let's say she wants to come and rent.
I know there were citations.
I come to the city and say, hey, tell me the
exact
number.
I don't think that that's going to be an appropriate. I'm not giving legal advice. I don't know if that's an appropriate thing to do for you to count police contacts or non.
Well, we do that on CCAP, though. We check CCAP to see.
Right.
So if she's a nuisance person, I don't want her.
But we're not designating people nuisance people. These are nuisance properties.
But it's your, I know you're designating properties, but it's not the properties that's causing the problem. It's the person in the property.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm wondering if, before we look at passing a nuisance ordinance, if we can start some sort of notification, because for years the landlords have been saying, if there is criminal activity or if there is problem activity at a residence, we want to know, because we as landlords don't want that on our property. We don't want people doing drugs. We don't want people allowing things to fall into disrepair. The things that you're seeing as nuisance activity, we can directly correlate to being an issue in our property. And repeatedly we've said, will you let us know when things are going on? And what I hear you saying is, we want to have a nuisance ordinance so that we can put some teeth into this and get rid of it. Could we, rather than saying we're going to start not fining, what are we calling it? Charging for repeated offense. Could we try to say, let's start some landlord notification, let's start some property owner notification, and see if this takes care of the nuisance issue? Because from our perspective, we don't want any of these things happening in the property that we own. If we could call and say, I'm thinking about renting to this person. Are they these things? And you could tell us, we would help to keep that out of our city, because we don't want that. We're not being negligent and just saying, oh, well, as long as we get some rent money, you know, we're going to allow prostitution and drugs and people leaving things in disrepair and people with weapons violations and all of these things. We don't want it. So if you can tell us when it's happening, can we see if this helps to solve the problem?
Hopefully I'll get to both your points there. Some of the things that we charge or cite, some of that is open or subject to open records requests. Some of that we may be released, some of it we may not be able to release by law. But getting to your point of starting notifications to start to work with us, but then what happens when the owners aren't working with us?
You know who they are right now. You know.
We've got nowhere to turn.
Nor do we. We have laws we have to uphold. Without knowing that there is potential criminal activity.
Any criminal activity would be on CCAT. I don't know if CCAT is.
But,
I can't vouch for that, and I don't, I'm not saying that that's okay for you to do that, but I'm just saying we're not, we don't, you know, we don't, our ordinance violations aren't obviously on CCAT.
Right. But from our, I have an example. We had someone live with us for 6 years. The first 4 years were excellent. Then he had health problems, started abusing prescription medication, started abusing other drugs. We came to collect rent one time. The police had kicked in our door. He had been in jail. A friend was paying his rent for him. And so we went 3 months not knowing that our door had been broken in, he had been incarcerated, and that there was drug activity. As landlords, that's really frustrating. We're saying we want to have this relationship. And if you had a drug bust in my property, I really wish you would have called me up and said, hey, we've carded him off, just so you know. But
I think on first, on strike one, not strike two, strike one. You know what I mean?
Well, it wouldn't be chronic. I mean, we wouldn't know, I think, is why we settled for two.
For two?
Yeah. Because otherwise it's just like...
Why is drugs
much.
Then one?
Yeah,
drugs is one with no abatement chance.
Sending out a lot of notifications. I mean...
Then you're serious.
Thing.
Then
can't,
you're really
can't
serious.
The drug
yeah, that's a lot of
I didn't rate
time
it.
And...
What's it costing us now?
They always tell us it's the same business.
And some, it probably will only be one contact, hopefully. And I think a lot of them are. And I don't know, we're probably only talking a handful of properties that would actually fall under this at any given time.
But it could very easily happen because we cannot control people from all those activities. We can't look at them and say, oh, this guy's going to do this, this guy's going to do that. We have no idea what they're doing.
And when I look at the ordinance as it's written, it's unclear to me because drug activity is considered a nuisance at its first offense. If that's something...
Delivery and manufacture.
Okay. So if I have someone in my property who has sold drugs, it's very unclear to me when I read this whether or not that means when you figure it out and you bust them, if it's a nuisance at its first offense, whether or not I can go through the steps to remediate.
Right, you're at, then if you're a nuisance, chronic nuisance premises, then you're at the abatement. With the drug manufacturer and...
So, because
then you don't get three, you get one. So then after one, you'll be coming, you will be having
is it after
plan.
One or at one? Because
well,
that's my confusion,
it
whether
be,
or not...
It has to happen, and then we follow through with it after.
Okay,
I
so
mean,
in my given situation, that was then a nuisance property because there was law enforcement action at the property.
Mm-hmm.
Can I abate that by evicting him? Or have I already paid for that first police
no.
action? And then?
No, if you, it's.
Then it should
it's,
state after.
The
any,
board tells it says that's a crime. It basically says you get three of all the others or one drug. And once you do the three or the one drug, then it's the abatement plan. After one,
so it's
drug, it's a chronic nuisance premises. After three of the others, it's a chronic nuisance premises. What happens when you have a chronic nuisance premises? Abatement plan.
I'm just wondering if, with the landlords, once they receive notice from the police department or from Ray Starks, if they can't actually, your landlord association, whatever you call it, if they cannot keep a database of,
that's illegal. It's,
of who these tenants are, what the violation was, when it was, and what the location was.
For us
so
to
then,
keep a blacklist is against the law.
For your, it can be a, something your own association can do?
It is against the law if we were to do that. We could share information with one another, but to keep any sort of database or blacklist is illegal.
Okay.
And not all property, or not all landlords are part of our association too.
But those aren't the ones you're caring about. You're caring about yourself, right?
Well, we care about them all.
So if someone is charged, then we can easily look that up on TCAP and note that there is criminal activity associated with this person. If someone is given a written warning for anything, if someone violates the...
like a citation?
Like those sorts of things that would not be on TCAP, we don't have any means to know if this person...
After the second time at your property, then there would be a notice. And then at the third time, there would be a notice. And then there'd be an abatement plan.
So NACUSA is working to rewrite theirs, and they're saying offenses after three written warnings. Instead of saying you get three, we're notifying you on two. When you say we're looking at 5-10 properties, this is not a widespread city issue, can we say then let's give us three written warnings
quickly?
No, but if you can understand that out of any property, we have about 9,000 properties in the city, and that means that any time there's a written warning anywhere in the city, a citation written anywhere in the city, we have to, you're saying we're going to send a notice to
every
property owner?
I'm saying if the police department is saying, I've been here, I'm on a first name basis with this person, this has become a nuisance, I want to put some teeth into this and I want to pursue it, I'm going to start notifying the property owner that this is becoming a nuisance.
Well, so that would be at least on the second time, wouldn't you agree?
It would.
So
but,
we're giving you the notice after the second time.
But then what I'm saying is, shouldn't we have notice for everything that counts?
We are giving you notice for everything that counts.
So you're saying...
after the second one.
After the second
after the
one.
Third one.
And after the third. And then the fourth counts?
And then there's an abatement plan. And then we meet with you and figure out... and then hopefully you stick to that. And then there isn't another, and there isn't a fourth
very
one. But
timely,
there is,
very inefficient and very timely, ineffective. This has got to happen sooner, folks. We've got buildings
but
that are
like
occupied.
But like I said, so you want, for any time anyone in the entire city is doing anything that results in
when
a warning,
he goes into that
who
squad.
Do we send the, then we're going to send.
No, what I'm saying is.
It, how do we even know that it's, you know, going to happen again? I mean,
do you know
why not two?
Which properties in town are
sure they know
chronic nuisances?
I think I've got one. I just got rid of them.
Offhand,
it took me about 2 months.
I can name some, but
yeah.
I don't know all. Our
so,
different crews, some crews deal with properties that other crews don't.
The shifts.
Yeah, and so.
And mine all moved down to NACUSA, so have a ball.
I didn't rent to them.
No, karma got her.
I have a, you know, we were talking before about the drug manufacturer's first offense.
Mm-hmm.
I have a huge concern with that because I was one of the unlucky landlords that experienced
mm-hmm.
that. And that property under this nuisance ordinance would be deemed nuisance immediately.
Right. So then the second time that happened, you might end up after an abatement. Well, I know, I'm just saying nothing's going to happen to you after the first time. You're going to come in, you're going to explain, I got rid of that person, or I'm working on getting rid of that person, or...
I had to get rid of him because I was given
a
notice by the police.
In your situation, you never, we never even sent, we might have sent you a notice saying, this happened at your house? Then you're good.
And what legal right do we have to get rid of people?
What they did...
This does not change your legal right to get rid of people.
There are no...
This does not affect the landlord-tenant relationship. This does not affect your lease.
Doesn't.
I don't understand,
How do you expect us to stop the behavior? How do you expect us to do that? We can't just kick them out because there was an underage drinking party. We can't kick them out because there was a disorderly conduct on their property. How do you expect us as landlords to stop their behavior?
Well, if you get four of those calls within 3 or 4 months, then you might get charged that continues to happen at your property.
How is that going to make it stop? You're not going after the person causing the problem.
You're just creating a new revenue.
And then that property is chronic for 6 months. So I get them out, and I put somebody new in, and all of a sudden they pull something on me like that meth lab that I have no... You know what I mean? And now it's 6 months. And then as a realtor, I know we have to disclose stuff, adverse fact. So now it's an adverse fact. So.
But there was a meth lab, but that has nothing to do with this ordinance that you have to disclose or that they
My point is I have a 6 month, you have 180 days, a thing that's got to go clean before that property is clean again. And we don't know in that 6 month, we can't, you know, whatever we're getting for rent, we can't hold it for 6 months.
Right, because that would be, right, if you have four,
it just gets, this whole thing is just getting worse and worse and worse.
Have you looked how effective it has been in other cities? I have talked to a major manager, Tanglewood Properties, and Travis says Stevens Point hasn't used it once, and it's been on the books twice. And so Stevens Point, you know...
Hasn't used it, mean they've never even sent a letter to a landlord?
That he's not received anything at his properties, and he is not aware. He's very pleased with that. But as his knowledge of City Hall...
That's a success story, then.
Yeah. Well, they've not bothered using it.
I know other cities that have used it, and it has helped eliminate some major headaches for them.
Can we get shorter time spans? We got to move along on this, guys.
I thought we worked on this already.
Yes, we did.
It went from 90 to 120. It increased.
Well, no, it went from...
Started at a year.
Yeah,
it went from
yeah,
6 months.
Year
it went to...
I thought the last one we had was 90.
Yeah. No, it went to be our advantage.
But it's
120.
It's 120 now.
Correct. It increased.
I'd like to know sooner.
Months.
I'd like to know tomorrow, guys. I don't know why there's not something on that squad that just can't give me that 1320 First Street North had a visit at 3 a.m. They don't need to tell me because I probably already know. And now she's down to Nakusa. But when you enter on the squad, why can't it just come to us and we can maybe subscribe to some kind of, I don't know why our IT cannot be a brainstorm behind this.
The internal workings of what's in the squad is not a public...
But you know the address.
You know the taxpayer.
Okay, and on the second time, we're going to send you the notice, just not the first.
Call us on the first. We want to know right away, not the second time or the third.
And I don't want to know 3 or 6 months later.
And I'm wondering why we can't try notifying the families of what's going on before we start charging a fee.
We do, the second, the third. Sit down with the abatement plan.
You even have an appeals process.
No, I'm saying right
even
now.
Even abatement plan.
Why
is
don't you tell us?
Person.
So the appeal process is going to go before city.
I just had
council.
Someone evicted, and the sheriff's department came and brought someone else
it's
along and said, we have suspicion that there was
reasonable.
Heroin activity
huh?
here.
We're pretty reasonable.
Why didn't you tell
and
me or
it.
Ask
pass
me about that?
Well, I have a question, but I'm waiting for everybody to get done.
I mean, just pass the ordinance. I got other things to do.
I would just like to clarify, because we're hearing some discrepancies on days. What has changed since we talked in April? Everybody was going to get together. We're going to have conversations.
We never got together.
What's changed, though, in this? I know it doesn't say landlord anymore,
It went from, was it originally
60 days. That number's been all over, so I just
90 days.
And it went up.
And it went up to 120 days, which was two, no, it went.
It was all over. It was.
Yeah, it went to your benefit, so that means that you have a shorter period of time within which to, I think we had 6 months.
Right.
And it went to half that.
Right.
So now it's more difficult to get in trouble because you have a short, you know, every, so yeah, that was changed, that was halved, which, so ours is, the ones I've looked at, that's a pretty small time period.
And did you change?
Other chronic nuisance.
Yeah, compared to other chronic nuisance.
We got rid of the chronic nuisance landlord designation. We got rid of how to compute who's a chronic nuisance landlord. They're not like, it's not a percentage of the property, so that if someone has a bunch of properties or something, so that was completely taken out.
But have we not brought it to your attention?
But everything you brought to our attention, I think she just covered.
90 to 120. It went from 90 to 120. Right. We last talked when Kurt was here, it was 90 days. We'd rather have 90 days than 120.
Wouldn't it be more advantageous?
No, because it's no, because if things happen, like you could get 3 calls to a property in a day. You know what I mean? So it gives it a longer time. I mean, you know, 3 calls, see if 2 calls happen 90 days and that third one happens, you know, at 91 days, it wouldn't be counted.
But we still would get the notice on the second one so we could do what we need to do.
We agree there should be a chronic nuisance. We just don't like the financial manner where you're coming after, where you're tacking us on that tax bill again.
And, you know,
like
it's
I said,
these,
we don't either. That's not
all these
the idea.
Things, these are police.
We want to make the correction.
This is what
no, but we know
what
modern light's done to us. And
well, we aren't modern light.
I know you're not, but it's very similar to us. It's very similar.
But aren't you guys the go-to people when there is a problem? I mean, isn't that what the police is for when there's harassment, disorderly conduct, crimes
well,
of violence?
Correct.
Isn't,
we can take care of that problem at that time, but then as soon as that person returns back to the property they're renting, it's going to happen again.
It might
and
not,
that's where we're looking for your help.
It well, might not be that they're renting. They could be visiting.
But right now you're not getting any notices about anything, and you're
exactly.
We're getting one after the second, after the third, an abatement plan. You know,
what is
and
set
all
up?
The angst and getting concerned that, I mean, I thought this would be hard to use, but it's like you're thinking that this is happening a lot in your each of your places and that we're going to be really busy with these. I mean, is
that's
that...
That's what I'm hearing is,
that
they know, like, they must think they're issues already. Otherwise,
we're into court. We know the courts are busy, guys.
We know the quality
well,
of tenants.
You don't
are
tell us
and
what
the quality of tenants
fee is
are
going
awful
to be.
Challenge. When they come here from down the south, you know they're not bringing good.
35% of these properties in Wisconsin Rapids are rentals. Look at the numbers, 65, 35. 35% are rentals. These people can't afford a house. They can't even get a loan.
Well,
you know
can
what
I
mean?
Comment as a resident? Yeah, I'm a young professional in Wisconsin Rapids, and I've been trying to rent. I won't name, names.
Name?
I won't name names. My name's Paul. I'm the city clerk. But I've been trying to rent in Wisconsin Rapids. And a lot of the reasons, like, I've had a very, very difficult time trying to find a place to rent because of some of the places I see and some of the neighbors I see, and obviously I know none of, you know, it's not all under your control. You can't control everything. But, you know, I'm a very attractive renter. And, like, I won't rent any of these places because of the riffraff that's around.
We don't blame you.
We don't blame
you.
It's all over.
But I believe some of the issues this is trying to address is to try to force, you know, give better areas for tenants
isn't
like myself.
More when the ordinance thing comes in to clean up?
Well, so it's, and yeah, and it's to help out the police from going to the same place time and time and time again and wasting taxpayer money. So
we're not the police.
That's just my 2 cents. I'm trying to find a good place to rent. As a resident, I think this would be a good idea because it could make for more attractive areas to rent.
Get rid of the person and not the property.
I'll tell you another thing cities are doing, they're putting in rental inspections and things like
don't
that.
Don't give
and
them any ideas.
No, they already know about it. But I mean, it's caused us to go to the state. We're going, in fact, I'm going to Madison tomorrow for a Realtor Day and Apartment Association Day, and to work with our state legislators to stop. I mean, there's a law, 176, that is stopping cities from, you know, and there's court cases on that. And it's like, you know, there has to be this balance. And you guys, city officials, are coming to these guys who are voted to make the right decision. And there's a side, there's this side, and there's your side.
Okay.
And they are elected, and they have, I mean.
You're talking of a balance right now. Well, I see it's kind of all falling this way right now.
No, we said we'll work with you. We'll agree. We agree to some of this stuff. It's just coming after us.
Guys, I think we need to move forward, but can we also look at a sunset clause then? A review at the end of anything that is put forth from whomever, when, to review it and see if it's just another 12 pages on the books that aren't enforced, or can we really tweak it around? Because a sunset clause is very important on all of our ordinances. Review, restructure, and go forward.
As city clerk, don't they always have recourse of contacting their
right,
alderman?
You can always
contact your alderman to revisit, to amend the ordinance.
I left that with sunset clause.
But that, like, if you came to my office and said, I don't like this ordinance, what can I do? I would refer you to an alder person to refer that to
refer
this committee.
Back to,
and
to
if they were willing to pick up, you know, or consider amending this ordinance, they could.
Let's do it right the first time, guys. Let's get it right, because you're reviewing
so many
things.
Well, nobody's
going to
agree on the numbers. That's the thing. I'm hearing 180, 120, 94. We're not going to do it right the first time, is my guess.
Well, another problem is you guys aren't giving us what the cost is. You know, you're saying that we're going to be calculating the cost of police or other staff response and enforcement for this and any subsequent nuisance activities and cause such charges and administrative costs.
Well,
where does it end?
Each incident could have a different cost for how many officers have to respond, how many times we have to respond. So
I've seen,
give a set number.
I've seen when the cops came in our neighborhood, there was four cops came. Four cops for what?
Depending on the call.
Three stood by the
car.
And we're going to pay for four cops?
I'm guaranteeing you it was a more serious issue that many arrived.
Probably not just bagels, huh?
Probably not.
Just pass it so we can go.
I just feel we need to make the tenants more
accountable
for their own actions. Don't blame somebody else or make somebody else pay for their faults.
It's never going to stop unless the person is accountable.
But how do we change these people, guys? The churches aren't there, the grandparents aren't there, the aunt's not there. Neighborhoods, good neighborhoods out in the valley. They pull down their shades, they let the dog out, and that's it. So we don't have neighborhoods.
Well, we know it goes deeper than what any of us in this room
we can't
can
fix
change.
It tonight, guys.
That's
maybe
right.
Start this and see where she goes. I don't know. But let's move on. You all have valuable time. I've got to caulk a bathtub.
Anybody else? I think we are very free with our let me speak. So,
Yes, thank you.
Nobody?
Yeah, thank you very
well,
much.
We appreciate. I mean, we're not. I'm not saying this is perfect either. You know, I'm pretty open in these things. But I heard back in April what you wanted city and staff to do, and I think they did make those changes. So, I mean, we can keep changing, but sooner or later, to your point, yeah, we are going to take a vote because that's what we're here for. So that's what we do on the committees, and that's what we're here for. We heard you. We hear you. But again, there's still 9,500 other properties out there that this includes, not just 3,500 or so you were referring to. And I'm not going to go back into the story of my dad being a owning rentals either, but we got to do something. And there's cities upon cities that have these ordinances in this state and all kinds of states, not just Wisconsin Rapids. You just said Nacoosa. I can't speak that I'm, to your point, you get voted on and off. I can't speak I'll be on this committee in another 2 months or even on the council in 2 years. But I can guarantee you got an appeal process, and most everybody that sits at this table will listen, I believe. If there's changes needed, you can refer it back, as Paul said, to.
Mm-hmm.
I was joking when you said you can't call me, because I know my phone's open all the time. You can call me anytime you want. I've talked to most of you in this room more than once, I'm sure. So, okay. We hear you, though.
Can we stay to hear you?
Sure. You can stay for the whole meeting if you want. My
I
guess
will.
Is after number one.
The tub's not going anywhere.
But All right.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you all. I make a motion for adoption of the chronic nuisance ordinance.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. Further discussion? Motion and a second, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye, opposed, motion carried. I got a question on agenda item three. Sorry to make you wait so long, Jen, but we kinda got different items in front of me. I might take them separately, I suppose. Or can I just put them in?
I mean, you can make separate motions for them, or you make a very long wordy motion.
Well, I guess, I suppose you could say, yeah, motion or, I don't know if you have to take a vote. I guess your motion just to.
Okay. We'll go right through, and then John, you can talk after that. Okay, so. Item three, consider various requests from Wisconsin Rapids Raptors for improvements to Witter Field. To include, A, request approval for the Raptors to remove some bleacher seating and replace the 64 senior box seats with a bar rail. The Raptors would pay for the seating and bar rail. Item B, request for city crews to assist in the installation of stadium seats. C, request that the city apply for a grant from the Northwood League Foundation for the installation of a cover for the accessible seating area. D, request approval to install a video board next to the scoreboard at Raptors' expense. E, request approval for the Wisconsin Rapids Raptors to sponsor a craft beer fest at Witter Field. The tentative date is September 9th. And F, request that the city assist in the cost of leveling off, regrading, and resizing the infield and part of the outfield.
I believe I put together, I'm John Fonta, the GM of the Raptors, put together a brief outline of the different proposed additions and improvements. I guess after speaking with the mayor a bit, Paul Ballard, and Sue Schill, I think we're going to rescind the request just because of a lot of other projects going on this spring, the request to help with the installation of the stadium seats. So that would go solely on us figuring out how to do that and take away from, not take away from all the other projects that city employees are working on, I guess. Although that is an improvement, we feel, to the existing facility and the property of the, will become the property of the city. The rest of the stuff is pretty straightforward, and it's improvement of the facility through various actions. And I guess just wanted to know if you had any questions on anything.
Yeah, I think we put together a recommendation sheet, and I believe then that John is in favor of all of those, or would be in agreement with all of the recommendations. I think you part of your packet, right?
Yeah. Except for B, right?
Right, and, that, and
B, yeah.
The recommendation was to, that, you know, we couldn't really guarantee that we could assist anyway, so.
I can't speak for everybody, John. If you call a few of us, we'd probably help.
I'm going to need your cell phone number after the meeting.
And I'm with Mr. Hepelis, I just know. So really, do we need anything special for E, Sue, or no? Just the fee, right?
Yeah.
Which is $250?
Right.
Just want to have that in there.
Right.
We're going to do one big motion call. Okay. So you would be with their fee of $250 paid. And really everything else is, and how much, what is F? Our contribution, is it
it's,
10 grand?
It's going to be $10,000.
As a former pitcher, that's a big deal to do that, so.
Yeah, it's, I mean, the field hasn't been, typically in baseball, a field's supposed to be re-graded and everything every 8 to 10 years. It's been since 2004, prior to the WEAC tournament being hosted here, from my knowledge, that it was kind of, some of the sod was pulled back, regraded a little bit to get it into the condition that it needed to be. With natural erosion and things and buildup from natural wear and tear. It's to the point where the grade level is definitely putting everybody, not just the Raptors, but the American Legion, the high school teams, players at risk.
Chris, wait, let me think now. Actually, you're better off, right? Because you're higher right now, so it's better for the pitcher. Not so good for the infielder. Okay. Anybody got any questions?
Yeah, you can just do A2F without B, right?
Without B. You got everything written down, right, Paul?
Yeah.
Right. I think it maybe if you just approve the recommendations, you know, regarding each one, because I think they, some of them have specific.
Okay. So just go right through them, huh?
The contained in the memo regarding each of the requests. Unless you want to do a motion on each one based on recommendations.
We can go pretty fast with each one. So I'll make a motion for approval for the rafters to remove the bleacher scene and replace the 64 stadium box seats with bar rail. With the rafters paying for that.
Second.
Motion and second. Further discussion? Motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Item B is off the table. C, request to make a motion that the city apply for a grant from the Northwood League Foundation for the installation of a cover for the accessible seating area.
Second.
Motion, you got them all already, don't you? Motion and a second. Any further discussion? Motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. You want to do D?
I will make a motion to approve the installation of a video board next to the scoreboard at Raptors' expense at Winterfield.
Second.
A motion and a second. Any further discussion? Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Sure. I'll also make a motion to approve the Wisconsin Rapids Raptors to sponsor Craft Beer Fest at Winterfield. Tentatively scheduled for September 9th, provided a fee is paid to the city in the amount of $250.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion? Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. F, I make a motion that the city assist in the cost of levying off, regrading, and resigning the infield and part of the outfield at a cost of $10,000, not to exceed $10,000.
Second.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. You got them all.
Thank you.
Step B. So we'll help. Four, consideration of a Class B beer and Class B liquor license application by Amy Friday, doing business at the Square Bar, located at 210 John Street, Wisconsin Rapids. Thanks for waiting.
Not a problem. It's been interesting. Are you sure you want to go through
with it? You guys want to say anything or no?
Nope. We're having fun. That's all I can say.
All right.
They have been operating under a provisional license.
Yeah, provisional. This is to make it okay.
Yep.
I'll make a motion. To accept the class or allow a Class B beer and Class P liquor license for the application by Amy Friday doing business at the Square Bar located at 210 Johnson Street, Wisconsin Rapids.
Second that. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you.
Okay, five, review and consider rate adjustments for non-resident and contractor compost site users.
So this has been in the process. This has been in the process for a couple years here, but unfortunately we lost the data last year, so we weren't able to come up with a fee structure. So virtually what happens is it costs about $160,000 a year to run our two compost sites. Based on usage, just some info for you. Contractors use the compost site about 3,475 times a year. Non-residents account for $10,000 on a yearly basis, and residents account for $31,000. So based on those percentages, that's how we came up with our fee structure. The caveat to that is we only have 25 contractors in the city, so it would be ridiculous to ask them to pay $2,000 a year to run our compost sites, especially when the majority of their material is coming from city residents anyways. So
Public Works came up with a fee structure as listed. We're just requesting from you to approve this structure. Virtually what it's doing is raising non-residents to $15 to $50, and then raising the contractor passes $50. But then any contractor that receives or has a need for more than two passes, we would then charge them $25 per pass. Like I said, in the bottom there, that there's 25 contractors that currently purchase. There's some other contractors out there that we have to get in the habit of purchasing tags from us, but that equates to 164 tags. And it's probably something that we'll probably look on a biannual basis, you know, to make sure that the fees are still relevant. There's other revenue that we get from the compost sites as far as selling of the compost and stuff like that, that will offset some of the costs, you know, from the contractors and things like that, because they typically are the larger users of the compost. They use them for filling in stump holes or whatever when they grind out stumps and things like that. So,
I want to make a motion that puts in the charges for attachment.
But it's 50 for non-residential.
Yeah,
here it says 5.
That's what the current is.
$50
for non-residents, $150 for two contractor passes, and then $25 per additional pass.
So it's virtually those last two sentences.
Okay. I'll make a motion then to approve the rate adjustments for non-resident and contractor compost site users. Changing non-residents to $50 and contractors to $150 for two passes and $25 for any additional.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion? Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Oh, thanks, gentlemen.
Okay, we're down to 8. Consider for approval of a 2016 transfer and revenue appropriation resolution.
Okay. If you go to the 2016 year transfer resolution, I'll walk you through it. In the general fund, one of the big changes there is that in the 2016 budget, we had a position for the Director of Innovation and Technology. As you know, we didn't fill that till early this year. So at that time, we were installing a new phone system that Solaris put in for us, and we were basically using the funds that were from that position 2016 for that. And that's basically just transferring that from the information tech operating budget to the outlay. We're also transferring some funds to the equipment replacement fund. That is to fully fund the depreciation for fire vehicles and the computer replacement IT. So those were formerly in the general fund, and now those are just being transferred over to the equipment replacement fund in the general fund. The housing rehabilitation fund, basically what it is, that's our housing grant, both that and the HICRI fund, that's our housing programs. And basically, periodically throughout the year, we get in loan payments, and then we earn some interest income. And then what we do is we take that money, and then it's relent out to fund those program expenditures. And so this is just appropriating those revenues over the expenditure account. The room tax is just adjusting the public, we budgeted $325,000 in public accommodation taxes. We got a little bit extra, so basically what we're doing is just appropriating that surplus revenue over to the three categories of which we disperse it. And that would be the economic development, the Visitors Convention Bureau, and the park outlay. Flip the page over. Grants and donations funds. This fund is basically if we get a grant or a donation for a specified purpose, we record it in this fund and we appropriate those revenues over to the expenditure line item. And a lot of these, so basically for this would be Wood County Hazmat and we received some funds from them, so we're putting that, appropriating that over to the fire department hazmat line item, so it's only specifically used for that. And then in gifts and donations, we get periodically over at the city zoo or for community benefit, we get donations in, so we're appropriating that revenue over to those line items for expenditure. Municipal Building Improvement Fund, this year we finally settled our insurance recoveries proceeds from the hailstorm, finally settled out with the insurance company on that, and we're appropriating that over to the Municipal Building Outlay for future building needs. The Equipment Replacement Fund, right there, is basically the equipment depreciation charges and copier depreciation charges that are charged to that fund, and we're appropriating that over to the replacement of fleet equipment and office and copier equipment. And then also the transfer from the other funds that being funding those two that I talked about in the general fund, that's where that money is going and being appropriated over. And in the Public Works Construction Fund, we had some miscellaneous sales of property. So basically what I'm recommending is that we appropriate that over to the Building Acquisition Fund. And that was about $19,000, and that'll pay for the costs of the two downtown properties primarily. So that is that one. If you have any questions, you'd be happy to answer them.
Let me get the furniture. Okay, I'll make a motion for approval of the 2016 Transfer and Revenue Appropriation Resolution.
I'll second the motion.
Have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion is carried. And item 9, consider for approval a resolution amending the 2017 budget.
Okay, I'll walk you through this one. This is one amending the 2017 budget. Start with the general fund. The big item there is that McMillan Library, we give them an appropriation each year, and then whatever they don't spend is basically carried over and they keep it on their books. So basically this is amending the budget to carry those funds over and increase their 2017 budget appropriation by the amount of surplus funds that they had in their left over in their 2016 budget. Also, we estimate sick leave payouts at the end of the year. Unused sick leave is paid out. We estimate that and place that in the budget. I calculate what the actual 2016 sick leave payout. Now I'm just adjusting the various operating accounts to account for the actual. In the housing rehab fund, basically what it is that any surplus they had left over in their 2016, because this is a grant account, and same for the Hickory, we're carrying those over and appropriating those, increasing the expenditures for 2017, so those are available for expenditure in 2017. The room tax fund, right there, the room tax fund, our current room tax funds the park outlay and economic development. These were 2016 surplus funds, so we're carrying those over. We're appropriating those in the 2017 budget, so they're available for appropriation. Flip it over. Same with the grants and donations fund. When we get grants and donations for a specified purpose, if those are unspent at the end of the year, we're carrying them over so that then they can be expended and available in 2017 because those are for a specified purpose. The EMS fund. Basically what you're seeing here is we're carrying over what they have in their ambulance outlay, and that's basically the replacement of their ambulances and ambulance equipment. But also in here is if you see the ambulance revenue and contracts are going up, this is where we're appropriating those unbudgeted revenues for the two EMS service contracts with two municipalities over into their outlay to pay for the paging system that we approved earlier tonight. Building Municipal Improvement Fund, that we're just carrying those funds over, that's what's left over, so that we're designating that for those for future building improvements. The Equipment Replacement Fund, these are depreciation to replace equipment. If you know, in our budget annually, we put monies aside each year to fund replacement equipment, and basically we accumulate those funds for future expenditures, and these are basically what were left over in the 2016 budget, and we're carrying those over into the 2017 budget. And the Public Works Construction Fund, the two carryovers that we have there is the Rapids East Industrial Spur. We charge businesses out there for the number of cars they use. We have agreements with them. We take those funds, those fees that we charge per rail car, and we put them in a fund, and basically that's be designated to be make repairs to the industrial spur. And then the building acquisition fund, those are just the surplus funds at the end of the year that we're carrying over to pay for. Currently, right now, the one is the town plaza. Any questions?
I'll make a motion for the approval of a resolution amending the 2017 budget as presented.
Second. Motion and a second. Any further discussion? Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carried. Item 10 was review 2016-17 liquor, beer, wine license applications of preliminary review. We've done that. Thanks for getting to us. 11, beverage operator license applications. I'll see what other.
I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second that motion. You have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed. Motion carried. 12, audit of the bills. We got the bills.
Make a motion to approve check number 066638 through 066948. And manual check number 099214 to 099228.
I'll second.
Motion and a second on the audit of the bills. Motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. Motion carried. Item 13. In open session, the committee will vote to go into closed session under section 19.85, para 1, para E of the Wisconsin statutes reads, quote, deliberating or negotiating, purchasing of public properties, investing of public funds, or conducting other specified business, whatever competitive or bargaining reasons require a closed session, end of quote. And A, continuing closed session committee will discuss negotiations regarding the purchase of properties in the downtown area. B, the committee may take action regarding negotiating parameters in the closed session, may adjourn in closed session. C, committee may return to open session, have continued discussion regarding the purchase of properties, and may take action on the purchase of specific properties. Move to go into closed session.
Second.
So motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. Motion carried. We are now in closed session.